Daniel O'Brien, the project manager.
Timothy Blunt, the design expert.
And Anthony Van Natty, the software expert.
John Tobias, the hardware expert.
So what we're going to be going through today is our motivation for wanting to pick this project, the requirements that we need to meet, the needs that we also need to keep in mind, the description of the system module, our plan for the winter break and next semester, including our testing, the risk and cost for this project, and the standards that we are using.
Essentially what our project comes down to is easy pass, but for a parking system. We want it to be unobtrusive, and we want to have human oversight in the system as well in order to prevent false positives and errors.
Now, the motivation behind this project is aimed at improving the security situation with parking in regards to Manhattan College. Now, we want to do that by enforcing more strict parking regulations while making sure that the cost of enforcing such regulation is as low as possible, while also decreasing the opportunity for mistakes and making sure that the system for regulating parking in the college is easy to operate.
So the basic description of the design is that a parking system will utilize an ultra-high frequency RFID scanner to record entering and exiting of registered cars in the parking lot. It'll remove any mistakes that can be made during routine checks on registered cars, because on campus here, they have the public safety officials walk around the parking lot, so they can make mistakes if they don't see something. And it also will allow for more efficiency without increased labor costs.
So some of the requirements that we've identified for the system itself is that it needs to have a range between 2 to 10 feet while also operating between the frequency of 860 megahertz to 960 megahertz. I'll go into detail later as to why the frequency is important. Now, another additional factor here that we considered was marketing for the system. So again, as I previously stated, the system needed to be easy to install while also having a low cost and having the ability to be operated easily without much personnel training involved. So one of the things that we've identified with this project was that RFID-based parking systems in the U.S. are actually not common. Traditionally, when you want to enter or exit a parking lot or a structure, there would have to be some sort of physical scan involved, whether it be a person sticking his or her hand out of the vehicle to input the ticket into the machine, or an actual security guard going up to the vehicle to physically scan the vehicle to determine whether or not the vehicle actually has a pass or not. And additionally, there's also a barrier at the entrance and exits for parking structures, making traffic slower and increasing the chance of any potential risks such as injury to other personnel involved or pedestrians on the sidewalk. Now, another thing that we've identified with the RFID was that in order to address the needs of making sure that parking is as streamlined and efficient as possible, is that the RFID component will be broken down into two parts. It will be broken down into an actual scanner and to car prototypes that can store the data of cars parked within the structure.
So here's the main system description. There's the physical sensors. We're using a Raspberry Pi for the processing and the database, and we have a user interface. So the physical sensors will have the RFID antenna and scanner, and we'll have the enter and exit sensors and also the camera for if there is no tag on a vehicle, we can still take a picture of the vehicle and still notify security that somebody's in there without an actual tag. In the Raspberry Pi, we'll have the control program and the RFID database. And then at the user interface, we'll have the notifications of the violations to security. We'll have the database manager graphical interface, which the security can input and modify and delete any kind of tag entries that they need very quickly. And also the RFID programmer, which is in the same system as the RFID antenna of the reader, but it is more on the user interface side.
Alright, so for this project, the hardware side, we decided to make a custom power supply utilizing an uninterruptible reserve. And the reason for that is because the traditional power supply for this is just going to be plugged into the wall, and God forbid that the power grid goes down for a day, a few hours a day, or a week. We want to keep the system running because once the power goes out and we don't have any reserves, our system gone, and then it'll cause a bunch of errors. We're using entrance and exit sensors that will be able to determine when a car is coming up to the scanner to turn it on and start reading. And we chose to use the Raspberry Pi 3B as our controller due to its processing power and ability to easily run Python code. This is the design of a traditional box switching mode power supply, which steps down voltage. We're taking an input from the wall, which is 120 VRMS, and we're stepping that down to 5 volts DC to run the Raspberry Pi. And this is the full schematic, the safe space. This utilizes a feedback system to regulate the voltage, so if the power from the wall outlet goes up or down, the voltage won't change the Raspberry Pi too much. And we also implemented a reserve battery pack just in case the power goes out. These are tested or simulated values from PSPICE. This is the 5x5 timer output as well as the charging capacitor. This is the current in the inductor going to the load, and this is the output voltage. It's a little bit blurry, but this is 5 volts, this is 5.02 volts. 5.01 volts, even though it looks like it's oscillating very, very high out of range. And those are the actual tests that we got, and it works pretty well. The yellow line on the bottom right is the input of 17 volts DC, and the green line is output to 5 volts.
So here's the functional diagram of the project. So we have our RFID antenna. We'll send out the RF waves and the tags, and also then read back the tags. The tag data will be sent between the antenna and the reader. The reader also has its own antenna on it that you can switch to program the RFID tags. And there's that system is connected through a serial connection with power and data to the Raspberry Pi. The enter and exit circuits will have two lasers that are pointed straight at photoresistors. By comparing the different the cuts in the lasers on the photoresistors, we can bring the data to the Raspberry Pi and so we can tell if they're entering or exiting. And there's also GPIO power going to the enter-exit circuit, which is 3.3 volts on the Raspberry Pi. That 3.3 volts power also powers the camera, which will receive a photo request and send back an image. And there's also a power supply which will supply 5 volts to amps to the Raspberry Pi for continuous power.
And then for our database, we've done a custom database in Python because other database implementations such as MySQL have too many advanced features for us and have more overhead. So we have a very simple Python database because we don't need a user identification. The only one really accessing the system directly is going to be a person interfacing with the GUI. And the GUI allows you to modify existing entries, delete entries, and make new entries. And you can also do this through terminal interface. And for the software side, we have the GUI interface that I mentioned, and we also have programs running to see if whoever entered the parking lot is allowed to park at that certain time, or if they exceed their allotted amount of time in the parking lot. If they have done so, public safety will be notified and they can manually come and check to see if that car is actually allowed to park or not. This is the behavior model. So once the car enters the lot, the sensors determine if it's entering or exiting. If it's exiting, it checks to see if there's an RFID tag. And if it's entering, it also checks. But if the tag is not found, public safety is notified, and a picture of the car is taken. If the tag is found, it takes that information from the database and puts it into a list of parked cars. Then it continuously checks that list of parked cars to see if they're still allowed to park. If they are, public safety is notified. And once they leave, they're taken out of the currently parked cars in the database.
Here's the GUI part of the software. So it is currently coded in Python using the Easy GUI library. It allows us to bring up GUI elements by just calling a function and putting in what values or features we want on the page. So the database is saved on a JSON file using dictionary organization, so we can call each entry by its tag number. So here's the main window. You have add ID, change ID, remove ID, and cancel, which we can program. So here's what happens when you add the tag to the database. You enter the number. You can enter the name and the pass type. And then it's entered into the JSON file, which you can see down below. The number, the RFID number, is related to the two strings of the name and the pass type. For changing the entry, you enter the ID tag, say what you want to change, the pass type with the name. You enter the change, it tells you the changes are made successfully, and the change shows up in the JSON file, which you can see on the bottom. So for removing, you just put in the tag again. If you want to continue, it tells you when it's deleted, and it'll tell you if it was unsuccessfully deleted as well. And as you can see, on that file, that entry is no longer there.
This is our upcoming plan for winter break and next semester. We pretty much have all of our parts. I think we might be missing one, maybe two components, but we can get those over winter break. And all we really have left to do is just to connect the system together and make sure that it runs without any flaws and troubleshoot if we have any bugs. These are the months that we want to have these specific things done. December, we want to really read our RFID tags and test the feedback loop from our power supply. January, plug the power supply into the Raspberry Pi and make sure the Raspberry Pi will run, and to make sure that the uninterruptible part will work if we disconnect power. In February, we want to test the camera and sensors, make sure they respond, and to make sure that the Raspberry Pi is recording times of entering. In March, we want to have everything connected and run different tests to make sure that under many different situations that our system responds effectively and accurately. And April is our deadline to finish testing.
And so for our go, no-go milestone, we want to have all of our simulations done and completed and yielding satisfactory results. We have the power supply going, the GUI works, although it needs to be tested with actual data and not dummy data. And we know how the RFID sensors can be hooked up, but we have yet to implement it because we only had the sensor for about a week. And the hardware has all been done, power supply created and designed, it just needs to be hooked up to the entire system and tested in order to make sure it functions properly. And for risk analysis, we have a low tolerance for error in the system. If a car enters and it doesn't have a tag, then public safety won't be alerted, and because the system is in place, they'll expect that every car in there is parked properly. And if a car enters the lot and is never registered as leaving, it'll be left in there, and public safety will have to manually check in order to make sure that this is in fact an error. And that's why we have human oversight. We can't completely remove error, we can reduce it significantly, but in the case that something does go wrong, we don't want to automatically issue a ticket to a student. And we also have interference from environmental conditions. So we're going to develop a custom case that will keep the power supply, the whole system enclosed and safe from water. And also we're going to use the no IR camera from Raspberry Pi, which is an infrared camera that can also do reasonably accurate color recreation in order to capture the photos for low light conditions and
Here's the cost analysis of the materials. So a lot of our parts, including the Raspberry Pi, the camera, and the SD card, we already had on hand, either for school or ourselves, and the other parts we needed to buy ourselves. The most expensive was the RFID scanner, because the actual scanner has to take like a system on chip up to a breakout board, which we couldn't do. We couldn't do a surface mounted soldering ourselves to get onto a breakout board, so we need to buy the breakout board, which costs about $200. The rest of our parts are listed here, and our total cost, including the parts that were given to us, is about $330 or $310 if we did have a Raspberry Pi Zero W, which is smaller than we had the
Now, looking forward, we plan on implementing the sensor and data into the sensor, and we also want to check to make sure that the programs are robust. Additionally, we'll also be testing the power supply to see if it's actually functioning as intended, so that when ConEd adjusts its load throughout the day, the system will still work even as power changes throughout the day. Most of the testing will be done around March through April. Some of the standards that we use here are IEEE standard for the RFIDs, which is 802.15.4F, and the FCC standards, and global standards of business. Now, all these three standards address are the frequency at which the RFID tags can operate, and also the range of the RFID tags. The reason why, as I said earlier, we have to operate at ultra-high frequency is that in America, the frequency at which that RFIDs are regulated is actually at ultra-high frequency, which is between 900 to 928 megahertz. Additionally, also, the range specified for an RFID tag operating at that frequency is about 3 meters. The Department of Building Standards also sets a standard for us for the power supply so that it operates at the proper voltage levels.
There are references that we used to find background on our project. And we have any questions?
So I'm curious about your choice of database and architecture using the Python. Python database, I guess in JSON, is that then going to be resident on the Pi, or you know, what is your overall architecture? How does where's the management console at? How does this scale to more than one parking lot? That type of thing.
The database itself will be on the Raspberry Pi, and the GUI interface and all the front end stuff will be on a remote computer. And we chose a Raspberry Pi because we can SSH into it in order to give it commands and tell it what to do. Also, the software for keeping track of what car is in the lot will also be on there. If we want to expand the system, we can add Raspberry Pi Zero W to it to manage a different entry / exit. And then we can also have those Raspberry Pis communicate through SSH.
Now, you said the RFID tag would be based in each car? So how would you prevent the transference to another car for multiple people using one tag?
The way it's currently set up is that the adhesive used for the Manhattan College sticker is very hard to get off in one piece. And even if you get it off in one piece, it won't stick to another car. We're going to implement the tag on that to where, like, if they design it, when they try and peel it off, it'll probably grip the RFID tag.
And also, the RFID tag will have information about the car. So you're driving a red Cadillac, for example, it'll have that in the tag, so you can't use it for multiple cars.
So you have an imaging system also?
Yeah.
Any other questions?
So, don't want to monopolize questions here, but does the Raspberry Pi have an onboard regulator? How much do you need to regulate the supply going into the Pi?
When looked up, the Raspberry Pi voltage needs to be between around 4.8, 4.85 to 5.2 volts. And the feedback system and the power supply is just going to regulate that to where if the input voltage changes, we have it through a difference amplifier and a pulse width modulator to modify the duty cycle at which the power supply runs at. So it'll change duty cycle to keep it as close to 5 volts as possible. The estimated variation of the output voltage is going to be between a 4.95 and 5.1 volts.
How much do you think it would be without that feedback?
It depends, because to choose a duty cycle, it's a percentage. So if it's going to be 170 volt peak all the time, then we can relatively easily keep that at 5 volts. But if that changes to, let's say, 165 or 160 or 175, we have a danger of either having the Raspberry Pi turn off or shorting out the circuits to too high voltage. Thanks. Anything else?